so much love in a game of Dota 2, but let's see what actually happens in the game.
Radiance.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Ucypher. My name is Vivek, with me is CloudX, and you're watching Team Yakshas on the Radiant facing off versus Team Yodhas on the Dire. Team Yodhas, they are coming into this match with
the Dire get a ban
by a point. They have won the game of Counter-Strike, and let's see if they can take on the Yakshas. There is a bit of history here. Some of them former players, you played with some of them back
the
in the day, and they played with each other as well.
Former teammates, now opponents playing off versus each other. Yakshas, I mean, unke paas punk hai, they've got themselves the age-old dinosaur of Indian Dota. I'm quite curious to see whether or not Yakshas can pull out ahead. Now, the last time we saw this team facing off, they played a coffee passive style of play. We had Acrid picking up the Bloodseeker. Bloodseeker, a hero that's meant to fight, but one that ended up farming. Didn't quite work out in their favor. Let's see what Yodhas has up their sleeves today.
Dire's turn to pay Earthshaker.
From what I was told, he did choke a bit under the cameras. And
Dire's turn to pay
But this time around, he's coming with a lot of confidence. He's
backed up
Dire
the riskiest
game
here
in the meta. And he's picked up with the strongest support.
Radiant's
the Earthshaker as well as the Lich. I presume this is a roaming Earthshaker while Lich will be playing the 5 position. The Yodhas, however, they picked up the Rubik. 11, the only other game we have seen him just yet.
Dire's ban now.
He ended up playing the Disruptor.
Here's the Radiant ban.
He's got a 5 that has the potential to make plays, and they ban
the Dire's turn to pick.
The Rubik as a 5 is something that I find to be very situational. I mean, mujhe nahi lagta that this is a hero that fits every single situation. However, this is one of those where with the Earthshaker and the Lich, there are a lot of high-value spells that can be survived. I like the Sand King going alongside Yodhas Rubik right now. I think Sand King's one of those that's versatile. It's still a very unclear lane matchup coming out from Yodhas. We don't know if this is going to be a mid park, whether it's going to be an off lane park. Sand King could be on the 3 or the 4 position. It's still, the draft is still really wide open for Yodhas. Yakshas, on the other hand, it's a little more predictable coming out from
them.
We know
that
Lich is going to be playing the 5, but the Earthshaker, he's slightly ambiguous
Dire's
again. But I don't know if he's going to be on the 3 position or if he's going to go 4. Slada, another hero that's sort of on the fence, but you know, more often than not, we see the Earthshaker going off lane, all thanks to GH God, of course, and Slada going on the 4.
I have an agreement with you. I think we're going to see a 4 position Slada here. Who'll be trying to have impact across the lane so that's out in sprint. Uh-huh. And I sense we're seeing an offlane Earthshaker. But
remaining.
This is not the best of offlanes to go to. I mean, I'm assuming once again that this is a 4 position Sand King. I presume the puck might be going to the mid lane.
Hold everything. Who the hell bans Zeus in this meta?
I have no idea. I think Yakshas know something that we don't.
There's a Necroforce in the game right now. He hasn't been picked, he hasn't been touched or even looked at so far. No Ancient Apparition picked up, no Ancient Apparition banned out either. Has everyone just forgotten the Zero exists?
Yeah, I mean, it's not just the Pugna, but it's not just the Necrophos, but either side would do pretty well to pick up the Pugna. More so like it on the side of the Yakshas. It's going to make life particularly difficult for the Sand King, who likes to first channel that Epicenter and then blink into battle. And as soon as you channel the Epicenter, you end up getting tagged by the Nether Ward. And that's going to ensure that you can't blink into battle. I really hope that Yakshas do at least, either side at least prioritizes one of these key green heroes.
You've also got to remember that Yakshas, of course, ironic as it is that they're green in green jerseys as well. The Pugna is one of Punk's all-time favorites.
Yeah.
We've seen him run the Pugna in the previous matchup. He was the only one doing any sort of work versus the Luna in their previous matchup.
Yeah.
I'd like to see Punk get his hands on the Pugna as a shot at redemption. However, this is one of those games where the Decrepify may not hold the highest amount of value, especially given that Slaughter is in the physical DPS department and Pugna is in the magic damage department. They're two worlds apart. They kind of cancel each other out, kind of work against each other in many situations.
They do. I mean, the Decrepify is not going to amplify the physical damage coming out from the crush, but you can still get the crush off.
This is something I was looking forward to. Yakshas going with the age-old armor reduction duo with the Slada and the Templar Assassin. So they've kept the Pugna on the back burner for now, and they're definitely going with the armor reduction slash physical DPS sort of play. Yodhas, I mean, they preemptively picked up the Sven, a hero that innately has a fair amount of HP to work with and buffs
Five
himself up versus
remaining.
Physical DPS with the Warcry AoE armor. This is something that Yodhas might have picked up regardless of whether or not Yakshas were going for the Zama reduction strategy. Again, because of the control that the puck brings to the table and the sand.
Here's the Radiant
Band. Sven is one of those heroes where, you know, you put a weapon in his hand and just hope that he beats up on whoever he sees in his sights. The only problem is if the opponents against you are mobile or if they have a way to stop you from running around, Sven gets kited, as we like to call it. With the puck, the Sand King, and the Rubik, they have reliable ways to hold heroes in position, and that's when Sven can take his Hatoda, or in this case his sword, and destroy his opponents.
Absolutely.
5 seconds
also
remaining.
Also worth noting that this is a Sven who's going up not only against physical damage application in the form of armor reduction, you've also got the Lich with the Ice Armor, which is going to make life particularly difficult for the Sven early on. A couple of points in Ice Armor, and it's going to be hard for Sven to get the skills that he needs. But then again, like you pointed out, there are multiple sources of lockdown. And provided the Sand King, Rubik, and the Puck just do their part and control the opponents in these fights, Sven should be able to clean them up. It's also a really crucial game for goes on either side to pick up BKBs. BKBs are going to play a huge role, and whoever gets a BKB really soon is going to be working with a huge advantage in the mid-game. Yakshas?
Yes and no, because I think the Yakshas, they're okay with dealing with heroes and their BKBs, right?
Yeah.
Even if you manage to pull out an early BKB on the Sven, that means you're essentially remaining, taking away some of his damage potential. And when the Sven is not hitting hard enough, that's going to be a problem, because Yakshas is going to be hitting harder with the armor reduction. All they've got to do is wait out that the Warcry, maybe use the Blink on the Templar Assassin in the absence of any damage over time on the side of Yodhas, by the way. Templar is going to be an absolute beast with his refraction charges. Yakshas have themselves a fifth pick on the board. They're looking for their carry, their hard carry, their one position, whatever you like to call it. Kya lag raha hai? What's going to be their final pick here?
Actually, I think that they should just go with the Pugna. Run a safe lane, Pugna.
That's,
I mean, you think Decryp and the TA is going to whiff, but I think the ward is going to make life so difficult for Yodhas in these team fights, and maybe run some sort of a utility Pugna who maybe builds a hut, a hood, maybe gets a mech, greaves, arcane boots, and just keeps the sustain going for his team. Let the TA and the Slaughter do the rest.
I'm not in agreement with that. I don't think that's the way to go. I don't think Pugna is the pick here for Yakshas. It's going to be a Spectre. I was going to say the Mirana, but Mirana's been banned out. Instead, they go with the Spectre. This is something we've seen earlier on in this tournament as well. It didn't work out too well. And honestly, this Spectre pickup, it seems like a remnant of the past. Now, Acrid and Cyberhen, they've both played Dota in the golden age of the Spectre. They played for a team known as Oblique Gaming back in their heyday, and
5 seconds,
I mean, let's face it, they were at the top of the Indian Dota scene for the longest time. There was no one that even came close to contesting their team. However, the meta has changed drastically since then. Spectre is no longer the unbeatable hero that she used to be beyond the 30-minute mark. There's items like the Silver Edge that have come out in successive patches. The break mechanic works beautifully versus the Spectre. Unfortunately, there isn't a natural Silver Edge carrier on the side of Yodhas, so thodi mushkil ho sakti hai in the late game stages here. But they'll go with the Ember. Another hero that's mobile stays the hell away from the Spectre, but a hero that's not so good versus the armor reduction on the side of Yakshas.
Yeah, I mean, the TA versus Ember matchup, we've spoken about this time and time again. Sure, Flame Guard works for refraction, but TA just chews through all your limited armor that you're working with early on. This matchup could go either way, and it's also going to boil down to the support that both mid laners are getting. What's working for Yakshas is that they have a Lich who's going to be denying range creeps, just being a pest in the mid lane. And I'm curious to see if Acme on the Sand King can keep up with him.
By your read, aapko kya lag raha hai? Kaun jeetne wala hai game? Based purely on draft. Let's not, you know, let's say there were 5 players of equal skill versus another 5 of equal skill. Who do you think comes out on top based on this draft?
मेरे ख्याल में यक्षास के लिए काफी इजी गेम हो सकती है. They've got what it takes to win. Their late game is secure with the Spectre. To some extent, I feel that the Yodhas are very invested in the early game. And I'm rooting for the Yakshas here.
I agree. I think Yakshas has the better draft here. It seems like it's a better thought out draft if nothing else. But this is just classic 4 Protect 1 Dota that Yakshas are going in with.
Spectre's going to be their Ladla Beta,
or in this case, Ladli Beti. They're going to be trying to protect her throughout the matchup. Once the Templar Assassin gets her early Blink Dagger, which I hope she goes for, they can make a lot of sick plays between the Slaughter and the Templar Assassin. The Slaughter may not entirely need the Blink Dagger early on as well, courtesy of the Earthshaker who's going to drop those Fissures to set kills up. I gotta say, I think Yakshas has this in the bag. They've just got to ride out the early game Storm that's going to come with a rotating Sand King, and they just need to make sure that the Templar wins that middle lane matchup versus what I assume should be an Ember Spirit.
It is also an offlane Puck coming out from the Yodhas. They're going to be running that Puck in the offlane.
It's a matchup where I think the Puck is fine, right?
I think the Puck is fine.
Because there's just one stun at the moment on the side of that Earthshaker, or rather on the side of that Slaughter. Getting in close for that stun is a really tall order versus a Puck. Blitz with the slows, Dagger slow coming out from Spectre. Maybe if the jaunt isn't in the right direction, or if it's not far off enough, they might be able to run down and finish the job. But theoretically, Puck ko offlane mein marna to nahi chahiye. He should not be feeling threatened. Should be able to come into the lane and farm convincingly and conveniently. And yeah, that's the only thing that I'd say that Yodhas has going for them in the early game.
आपके ख्याल में इस गेम स्पेसिफिक टू दिस गेम डू यू थिंक दैट एम्बर विल बी गोइंग मैजिक और फिजिकल
टफ क्वेश्चन बट
आई मीन काफी फिजिकल डैमेज है बट डू यू थिंक ही नीड्स टू ऑगमेंट द स्वेन इवन मोर
नो आई थिंक ही शुड गो फॉर मैजिक डैमेज हिज जॉब शुड नॉट बी टू टू लेट गेम डीपीएस He needs to be the one controlling the game in the early and the mid game stages, and more importantly, he needs to get to the point where he gets Searing Chains off cooldown on the shortest possible notice. That's really his value. He has to play this utility style of Dota where he's controlling the map and controlling the team fight for the Sven to get the damage output done.
Right, so just provide as much control in these team fights so that the Sven can go in and clean them up. I feel that the Yodhas have put almost all the cards into the Sven. And they're really hoping that Sven can do all the physical damage that's expected of him. The rest of them, in a sense, in these team fights, they're just going to ensure that they're there with the control, with the stun, with the lockdown. Sven can come with his Hathoda or his sword and just smack them in the face. A pause comes in.
On the other side, however, it's slightly different, right? Because you've got the Templar Assassin that can do a lot of damage on towers, let alone physical damage on heroes as well. But one way for Yodhas to approach this game is by building things like Ghost Scepters early on. And just somehow forcing out a Diffusive Blade on that Spectre as opposed to something that we all know she wants to get, which is the Radiance. Every Spectre's wet dream is to pick up an early Radiance and to basically make sure that the supports are getting destroyed on the back line. This game may shayad that's too much to ask for because the Diffusion will hold value versus the spend. You might also want a Manta for the Puck and the
I think this could be one of those games where you probably skip the idea of an early Radiance and look at it.
30 seconds to battle.
The Yakshas being pushed away from their own rune. VP though needs to be careful. 11 on the Ruby, he's a little far. He's getting in range for the Telekinesis, the Bottle Strike. Not sure he can make it. Akmit takes the chance.
Unnecessary. That was absolutely unnecessary from Acme. All you've got to do is what we're doing. Hover over your Burrow Strike and you'll know how far you're going to go. Anyway, he's not going to get that stun off. Misjudges the range of the Burrow Strike and because of that, they're not going to get First Blood. But at least they're going to get the rune. We are looking at VP trying to contest
and
top
rune,
but
clear
he's
for running.
Late to the party. Or is he? The crush is there and it steals the bounty. It's 2 apiece and the game starts as it was meant to, with both sides flatlining the graphs.
Yeah, Shondi, I'm not sure if he wasn't paying attention, but from the high ground, he should have been able to see VP approach him. But he was holding onto a skill point and was more than comfortable to give away the bounty rune just so that he could use that skill point a lot more widely. Mid lane, though, VP goes in. He wants to get the crush off. 11 is waiting for him. He lifts it back up towards the tower. The two-man crush is going to buy VP a little bit of time, but he's lost a lot of health. And this means this is going to be a base trip for the Slaughter. 11 on the Rubik should ideally harass the DA as much as possible in the mid lane. And it seems as if him and Gondi are doing just that.
That said, I think Always Alone is still doing fine in this lane. Even with 11 here, they're not really pushing the TA that far out. She may not be getting the most amount of CS, but she's in a cushy spot. But as I say that, the lift and the throwback was there.
Yeah.
Always Alone does have himself that salve, so he's going to be fine for now. Lots of denies from Gandhi, sort of slowing down the TA's progression in this early game towards those first few items. I like the fact that 11 has just committed to being in this middle lane for now. He knows that Gandhi
is going to be especially with Zara coming in time and again.
And the Bunk consistently denying that sacrifice range creep. But that's where the Lich holds the most value, right? When there's two heroes in front of you, Lich sacrificing the range creep only means that both of them are going to be starved further out. And in the mid game stage, Templar will be the victim.
Yeah, I mean, so far, if you take a look at EXP between the Templar Assassin and the Ember Smith, it's pretty even. Nobody jumping ahead to scare. But yeah, as time progresses and the TA is going to have more range creeps approaching her, she's definitely going to get EXP provided she gets the last hit on those range creeps. How's Puck looking in the offlane, doing rather well for herself? She's hit level 2, doing better than the Earthshaker, who actually put his first kill point in Fisher early on. I guess it's correct. You maybe want to put a point into Enchant Totem after you get a point into Aftershock, and then approaching the Swen and being a nuisance in general is of a higher chance for Kalank on the Earth Shaker. I've been watching Kalank in other tournaments as well, and he's been rather impressive in the offlane. He plays a mean Nature's Prophet. He's excellent at split pushing, and in my opinion, on the side of the Yodhas, he's one of the stronger. On the side of the Yakshas, he's one of the stronger players. Excuse me.
Well, Always Alone has the Frost Armor came upon him early on, so we know which direction Lich is going in, but this is a bad spot for the and the lift is there. The Burrow Strike to follow it up, and First Blood goes over towards Acme.
First Blood on the
this sand. Time, his Burrow Strike was on point, and with that, he's already got his boots on land. Even going to pick up a secondary smoke. Maybe we see them make another aggressive rotation towards
bottom lane. VP trying to push out the path here. Sorry, the smoke coming in. Was that around mid? I missed that.
No, they've actually just picked up a smoke on the center.
Okay.
So they haven't popped it yet.
Okay.
Denied.
So far, so good for the Yodhas. They're holding their ground, they're getting their farm, and they've got themselves that kill on the middle lane as well. The only way this could have gone better is if Gandhi got himself that first blood money instead of the sanding, but that's just me nitpicking now.
It is, but it's also important because as an Ember Spirit, more often than not, when you go to the mid lane, you end up losing the matchup purely in terms of CS. Your means of recovery is participating in teamfights and hopefully scoring those kills. And that's how the Ember starts coming back into the game, especially if you run him in the mid lane. There are very few matchups, in my opinion, where the Ember excels. There's always the question who wins the matchup between the Storm and the Ember.
I don't know, man. I'm going to disagree with you on that because I think the Ember's a pretty solid laner himself.
Really?
Mostly because he's got the ability to push out the lane. While we're talking about that, Acme snipes another bounce. He is going to get beaten up for it, but killing him is going to be hard, especially because the Templar's not going to add that much value this early on in the game, and because Acme's got boots and a salve.
But, I mean, Ember in the mid lane.
All on
regeneration!
Dragging Ucypher with him.
He's actually going for the next bounty rune as well.
This is ridiculous. VP is waiting for him. He does have a crush, but does VP have any health? Not really, and Acme.
No Orb of Venom, no additional ways to stop Acme here. He's just walking about, and rightly so, space has been created. He's not gonna die. He's forced out two crushes from the Slada. This is some clowny stuff coming out from VP, and it's a pointless chase coming
this
out.
This is VP wasting time and mana right now. And I hope VP's taking a look at the clock, because in a couple of seconds it's going to be a strike. And Lag, though, he's gonna take a look at his own fountain for a bit as 11 gets the kill with that last auto attack.
Off to a solid start. We talk about our Yakshas needs to simply keep it together in the early game series, and this game will be there. It's Yodhas are doing the exact opposite, just forcing them into pressurizing, wasting time on both their supports and scoring skills on their cores. So far, both the deaths on the side of Yakshas has been on the cores, the middle Templar Assassin and the top lane Earthshaker. Both heroes that are very snowball oriented and heroes that need that early start.
Yeah. Earthshaker needs that link. The Templar Assassin, though, she can fall back to the jungle to recover. Which is why I'm curious to know, has Punk been stacking? Yeah.
Punk's been doing his thing. He knows it. Punk is sort of the unspoken captain of this team. While Acrid may be leading the charge outside of the game, inside of the game, it is Punk that's making these very minor level decisions that are working in their favor. I'll hold that thought for now because Gondi's the one in trouble. With VP coming in from behind, the auto attack damage from the refraction charges is still there and Gondi will drop. The return kill comes out, Deathhound Assassin claims the money, and Eleven can do nothing but watch and smack him in the back.
I'm not sure what Acrid would love to on this fan game. It looks like he's spending
the time. I found Yodhas on bottom lane the hair because Ab just told him. Sacrifices his life to get a kill on the Lich. But that was a throw, as we like to call it. You don't want to give money up to the Spectre who becomes an absolute beast if you feed him. Totally not worth it for the Punk.
Not worth it. I mean, not worth it at all. Diving deep, managing to kill off the Lich, but really, I think that's not accomplishing anything in the early game. In fact, it's only worse if you go to the second like you mentioned. Apu or Abs trying to kill Punk once more. This time actually in the vicinity, he dies as he gets the kill. They'd like to kill the Spectre with the ice armor upon him. Eleven comes in, lifts up the Spectre, they're struggling to shoot through an HP. And he's just gonna turn around and bully the Sand King out of lane. Comes into the lane.
I'm not impressed by DP, I have to say. I think he needs to be in the he needs to read the map a little better right about now. And if he's not able to read the map, he has to ensure that he has a TP stolen on him. Dives like this should not be allowed, absolutely. Again, it's just blowing crush after crush and not really getting that much done.
He's wasting mana. This is not even gonna amount to a patient for the pocket. What's my sim is 11 and Acme are on the hunt once more. They want to kill on the Temple Assassin, who are probably forced to go back to the jungle. The TA in the mid lane, low on mana, the Lemnitz are there. A telekinesis from 11, followed by the Butterfly. The chain stuns. Perfect. And Gondi this time scores the kill.
Strike, this is a pristine way to execute the gank. Perfectly done. 11 and Sand King, aka Abs, completely in sync with each other, making the play. Meanwhile, looks like Abs is going to end up getting VP once again in the bottom lane, but Durka is there here to this time finish him off. Abs is trying to run. Orbs back in 1 second, but it's not quick enough.
So Durka has 2 kills, and this means that the Spectre is... Well, she's just a goal for the Vanguard. It's an 8-minute Vanguard coming up from the Spectre, which means that she's only going to get harder and harder to kill. And if she picks up a couple of infused raindrops, it's pretty much going to ensure that the Swen has to make a rotation to kill the Spectre.
I agree. This is looking really difficult on the side. Well, this is looking difficult to kill the Spectre.
Yeah.
But elsewhere, the Swen has just been free farming. His Mask of Madness is almost complete. And middle lane, Gondi's free farming as well. Templar does have the CS advantage granted, but Gondi did end up getting that kill on Templar Assassin, so the net worth drops slightly closer than they should have been. But it's clear, it's pretty evident that the Templar has won middle lane.
Yeah.
And more importantly, because the stacks are still available to be picked up.
I'd really like to see Eleven and his boys get some vision around the stacks, maybe try and contest them. It's something that they could consider getting the stacks over to their Swen could really help them out in the mid game, and is only going to hurt the Templar Assassin a little bit more.
Yeah, I'd like to see that as well, but it's such a risky play to go in.
It's a risky play, but I mean, when do you take the risk? When you're taking, when you're missing all your
Dirty Towers,
you really can't take
risks
then.
Abs getting beaten up by VP. This time, I think VP's movements are sort of justified. But again, this whiffing crush after crush. I don't think it's necessary to even bother committing with a crush on Abs at this point. It's not like you're going to kill him and you're not really zoning him out either.
Yeah, he could have possibly pump picked it. He had the opportunity to cancel it, but Abs, VP is getting a little trigger happy. This time around, they could attempt Radiant to bring down the pump. VP, the circling around. He's pump picking the crush, he connects, but Durka doesn't want to commit.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I don't think so.
No, Shrine's been used already, so no Shrine available for a while, not 170 seconds to be precise. I think DP ko bottom lane chhod dena chahiye. He can just go towards the middle lane and manage
to get
it.
He can do so much in the mid lane. Because Acme and 11 are waiting. Acme and 11 have focused their energy.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
He's just got 2 points in sacrifice and one in the first armor. He's a rather reactive support to Lord
Gaffer. Hal Nayak's in trouble. He's got a butter strike after the storm hammer coming down. 11 with the lift after the play force. Again, they're just on the same page. It's like this is a team that has practiced, this is a team that's played together. And they trust each other to chain their stuns perfectly. Yeah. They're playing some good Dota.
So Shawnee's got the tower, and Swen ends up picking up that kill as well on the Karnak.
Big stuff coming out from them. They're going to get a lot of money because of this.
They're trying to bring down Radiant's top tower.
And Acme spots out the stack. What is Acme doing?
Space created.
I mean, I'm not sure if this is space. He could end up going down. He bounce strikes to the high ground. He's going to get away, actually. So one of the biggest problems I have with how the Yakshas are playing this is that BP is never at the right place at the right time. He's not even close.
And that stems from the mindset that, oh, we've got to protect our Spectre. Spectre hamari ladli beti hai. We have to stay behind her, make sure she's safe. That's the wrong way to approach it. Your Spectre has a Vanguard. She's not going to die that easily. Just keep a TP scroll and go mid instead, because mid is where you should be focusing your efforts for now. Shutting the Ember Spirit down, and giving that Templar the winning momentum that you need. But it's not gone so badly for the Templar. He has been shut down. He's coming with a Spirit Chains at mid. But Funk is in the vicinity as well. A scroll and Spell Strike is turned on to Always Alone. Here comes BP. This time he's in the right place at the right time. But the Spirit Chains will hold him back again. 11. Not gone down just yet. He's trying to turn back around. With the stolen bell, he holds his ground. Turns and smashes BP, even the horn committing. But Spectre doesn't come in. So much commitment for an attempted kill on a Rubik. Yakshas have made a mess out of it.
Yeah, Yakshas will be a little disappointed with themselves. And that's
bottom.
Bottom lane, the corner of DOTA. This is a huge fail. Acme goes in with the epicenter. The Spectre could end up playing with the dispersion. Does hurt a little bit. Acme wants to go in. He has the off coming off through down with the mid, but Galaxia, Echo Slap, Fisher, he punishes that for his time. And DOTA will live.
If only this happened earlier on, they'd have managed to get themselves to kill on the side as well. Not even going to complain about that, it works out so well for DOTA because again, he just stays alive through an attempted gank. This time it was a Dream Coil and an Epicenter committed by Yodhas. And while Yodhas may have been outplaying them for the most part, this is where that draft kicks in. This is where the Yaksha's draft starts to get supremely stronger. And I mean, in a game where both teams were evenly matched, Yodhas wouldn't even stand a chance at this point. The fact that they've managed to give their Sven so much momentum is sort of keeping them in this game for now, is what I'd say.
That's exact.
I mean, I don't know. In my opinion, I still think it's rather close. 11 and Acme have been rather splendid with their movements. VP needs to start getting active, and he needs to get there soon. The TA caught on a boot, is farming the stack. A lot of unreliable gold taken away thanks to Gandhi. And the stacks, some of them cleared up.
I've got to say, I'm impressed. They're making some really smart decisions. Decisions that we see taken on higher levels of DOTA. It's the mark of a team that's on its way to being professional, but they're improving with every passing game.
So BP needs to do one of two things. I mean, just to break down what BP is doing wrong, I'm not sure what he did for the first 2 minutes. Around the 6-7 minute mark, when the puck has levels, he's trying to bring down the puck all by himself. While all of this is going on, multiple ganks happen in the mid lane. He hasn't kept a TP even now. And there's no way he can do it. I mean, Acme and the puck could go on Spectre once more. And BP is not going to be there. He's not holding on to a TP. This is such a bad mistake. They're trying to bring down Gandhi. I appreciate this, but Gandhi has a remnant by now. BP should have been doing this a couple of minutes ago.
Exactly.
And BP's being punished for his bad positioning early on in the game.
I mean, this is where the butterfly effect kicks in as well, right?
Exactly.
Because if he did this earlier on, Templar might have been a bit more farmed because of the lack of the debt on her. That lack of a debt would have allowed her to take the Ancients without actually dying. And they would have been in such a better and more comfortable position now.
Absolutely. However, the only reason 11 and his team have that 3,000 net worth advantage is because BP's not been in the right place at the right time.
Well, for now, Always Alone is making progress towards the Desolator. He's sitting at level 12, about 14 minutes in. They're going to pop a smoke of their own, but the lack of lockdown coming out from the side of Yakshas may come back to hurt them.
They need Kalang to be there if they hope to get this kill.
He's got a dagger, by the way.
Yeah.
This is the turning point for them. They could jump into the Echo and follow up with a...
There's the Echo Slam Fisher to follow. Crush as well. They throw everything and the kitchen sink onto Gandhi, and they get the kill that they were looking for. Heavy commitment, 4-man rotation for the Ember Spirit, but a kill is a kill nonetheless, and BP is getting carried away. He's moved into the dire jungle, does not get that one board off. But can 11 or Acme punish him for this?
Well, getting close to his Blink Dagger as well, by the way. He's at 1100 gold now, and I think if he just stays alive for a little longer, he's going to have it. No real kill possibility here on Always Alone between just the Rubik and the Puck. Tepla knows this, which is why he's okay with pushing the wave beyond the river and then walking back.
Mm-hmm. The good thing about VP's play is that although he's not been participating in crucial fights, he has somehow managed to make
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Actually, scratch that, because Acme is going to get it much sooner on the sand cake. He's sitting at 1.8k gold, and the Yodhas, it seems as if they want to enable Acme a little more and get him the blink early on. They pop the smoke, they move into the Radiant Jungle.
The hardest kill they could ask for.
All by herself, she's got the Vanguard, but with the coil and a whale in him, and Godly moving into the Veil of the Scott. How do you survive? Godly scores another. No TP rotations coming into the Yakshas, but they're left running away from their own jungle.
This is the issue with the Spectre that tries to go for the Radiant Sentry. It may be an outdated build coming out as well, because it's a lot of unreliable gold that you keep farming. What unreliable gold essentially means is that when you die, you end up losing more of it. So right. You're back to where you started. You have to farm all over again. And if you die while you're farming, you'll never ever get that radiance. That's exactly what they need to do on the side of Yodhas. Just constantly go for these rotations and ganks. And they have a power spike. They've got the Veil of Discord along with a lot of magic damage on their side. Shandi's gonna farm significantly faster than anybody on the side of Yakshas at this point in the game. If they can leave him alone to split push and farm like he's doing so far, Radiant's they're gonna pull further and further ahead in terms of net worth until there comes a point where Yakshas will be forced to defend their high ground. And at that point, Khalnaik is the only threat, but elsewhere, they're gonna fight Zulfin. And we talked about the Blink Dagger. It's not coming on anything soon, but Khalnaik is gonna spend the favor and actually go down. Shandi, however, does be down. The Blink One, he gets a game plus right in the middle of the train. They're gonna go in and hit them, and you want to get them, and they'll go down. The Destiny is
going
to be the kill. The only survivor making a run for it, heading back up and flips, gets hit with the Belser, gets slowed by the trap, and then gets hit by the Fisher. The double damage to the top of the headman. It's a team wipe, and Yakshas have delivered.
Beautiful stuff coming up from Yakshas there, knowing that the choke point of the trade drop is so much worse. Khalnaik is a movement in terms of the Ucypher spawn, but it got the fight started on a good note for them. The slot up, I mean, it's a debt on him. His blink is going to be delayed, but what's crucial is that the TA scored huge in that team fight. A huge ultra kill, a lot of money to work with, and the possibility of a blink or a BKB coming up soon enough. I was just going to say prior to this fight that the Spectre needs to start fighting early on rather than hoping to get that Radiance. I mean, Radiance does let you farm well and helps you farm fast, and it does give you evasion and a little bit of teamfight presence with your Haunt. But I think something along the lines like a Diffusal or a Mantra style is going to do a lot of good for the Spectre in this game right now.
Yeah, we gave VP a lot of health.
Our fortifying structures can't be breached. I could.
He died, he came in the middle of the fake, got into a scene and crushed.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
And gets them a team wipe. That's how worth it was that for this Spectre. Now she's so close to the relic. Once she gets the relic, I think it's smooth sailing for them up until the high ground at the end of the game.
It is, but Spectre didn't get a single kill. I think she got some assist gold and she was just there looking pretty. But yeah, now the net worth difference between these teams only at 1,000. Sven, he's going to be a little disappointed with himself. He got the Sound of Yasha as well as the MOM. Still got kited pretty heavily in that fight. And Shandi, I sense he's not going to be looking for fights until he picks up a blink or maybe.
Got himself that blink dagger for a while on this. It's not such a transition too much. We did see him jumping into the winning with the game point. But one of the major issues of that last fight is they were fighting up onto the high ground.
Yeah.
And they had the vision disadvantage on the side of Yodhas. Yakshas just exploited it to the maximum and came out all down. Acme's
got a blink from the tanking. So
Radiant
something that the Yodhas are working with. Has Slana got his blink?
Slana does not have his blink.
Okay.
I mean, I don't even need to look at him to tell you that now. The dieback hurt him earlier.
So, DP was he was passive in the lanes, or rather, he was ineffective.
Oh, here we go.
He not be
Epi said,
what?
I mean, this tournament has been about how you can psych out your opponents, and when that happens, I'm really surprised that no one just got up and walked from one camp to the other to flame them.
I think Acrid just underestimated or overestimated the range of the blink dagger. And Durga just walked away casually. I mean, even a butter strike into an epicenter could have worked, right? Because the Spectre can't really cancel the epicenter.
He played it as if he was playing like a 3K MMR pump game, hoping that the Spectre walks into the tower and right
stands there.
Just stands there. Come at me, bro. That's not happening. At least not until she's got a Radiance.
She's getting quite close, actually. Durga's been doing rather well for herself. They really need to punish the TA a bit. I mean, but it's a little risky because you don't see anything above the Radiance. Shanti's gone back to farming. He's holding on to a lot of gold. He's going crazy.
Alright, yeah. Blink it is. He definitely needs that blink.
He does. He needs to possibly jump onto the Earthshaker, maybe even the TA, and eliminate them as soon as possible. Shandi, Eleven and Acme, they're walking to the lane. The Yakshas have smoked up. The TA is waiting for an opening. She's got a blink dagger of her own. Shandi needs to be there. Gandhi all by himself. BP, he can't jump in. They need Kalang to initiate. Both teams poking and prodding in the mid lane. They say hi, they say goodbye, and they run right back.
Doesn't this feel like the Radiant are scanning Shandi for enemies. Piece of chicken that they're just fattening up to eat later on? They're okay with him farming as long as he doesn't get his BKB early on. And honestly, with the armor reduction and with the ability to kite around that Sven, they don't really care that he's so fat.
Soldier's fortune.
Oh man.
Always alone. She's standing under cover of Bell. Kanayak, he could open the blink of magic, jump in on top of that. Let's step on Kanayak. Kanayak waits for too long and got punished. The haunt is there. Always alone. Focusing 11-11 with the stolen refraction. Can't survive for too long. It's Dirk all comes again. The chain from bouncing. Fuck with the chain to try to stay alive. Acme moves towards the new blue. Will take a couple of bounces but might just end up surviving. However, Dirk out with the corrosive ace will get the kill. Meanwhile, Shandi on the back line wants the TA and with the chain coming out from the Ember, they get the kill. Apps looking for more, doesn't have the coil, they've already scored 3 kills and they've lost only the new pick. This game is so back and forth.
Yodhas making the right decision there. With the minor power strike they got with Shandi, they definitely wanted to take a fight. He was supposed to go into that fight until they found Kanaya.
How can they find Kalang? I'm not really sure, but it was actually the TA was scouting them out. Kalang shouldn't have hesitated.
There was a Dire Observer Warrior. I think they saw him going in there. Post with the flying vision from the illusory option, might have seen him.
Yeah.
Didn't quite catch that on camera entirely, but
trying to find a response here. Shandi caught in the fish of VP coming in. He's got the clutch. Corrosive Ace as well. Gandhi nearby. Pops the blink dagger. Wants to go in. Veil chain. Securing the retreat for his brother Shandi.
He's not really his brother.
I mean, they are. They're Karan and Arjun.
Well,
look at them. Look at the two brothers. Shrining together. They really love each other. But Gandhi, he's got the Veil of Discord. 2.2k gold. I presume he'll be going for the BOT.
Is it the BOT or the blink dagger? I think he purchased something right now. Yeah, it's the BOT.
Yeah, look, the Indian default is mid one does and just put it in your quick buy. And mid one goes BOTs first now. I mean, it's his go-to item. I don't know why. I can't justify that choice always. But yeah, I like the BOTs. Let's see if we push a bit. TA doing rather well for herself. Has the blink and the desolator. Once her own AKB. I don't blame her.
This is one of those games where the Lincoln play is so valuable on the side of Yakshas, to be honest. There's a lot of single target damage coming out, single target stuns coming out on the side of Yodhas. Having a Lincoln player in the game might be useful. Question is, do they have a hero that can build in at all?
Yakshas. For the Yodhas? For the Yakshas, yeah, indeed. A Lotus Orb would also be good.
Yeah,
there's a lot of self return, a lot of things to remove as well.
Lara is an ideal candidate for the Lotus Orb. Yes. That should be a
part. Dire's middle tower is under pressure. Radiant's bottom tower faces a stiff wind.
Like the most disgusting and perverted way of this, man.
Dire's middle tower is drowning.
Letting him farm the Radiant. If this was a magic game, they'd all be slapped to waste their bandits, man. No priority pool was made for Dota like this.
I mean, then China in a year would be in low priority for the rest of the year. That's what they did for an entire season.
A prize.
Still a 3k net worth advantage to the Yodhas. The problem is the Spectre and the TA still have a lot of room to scale.
A tool to teach.
And with Kalak and the Earthshaker, provided he doesn't get picked off before, These team fights could very easily turn into Yakshas, but look at this.
The vibe I'm getting from this game is that
let's just farm an item. Win.
And then let both teams, some of them probably texting each other, let's go fight in the mid lane. They all show up in the mid lane.
And then they all just shout Akramar and they go at each other. That's basically what happens.
Yeah.
No one is thinking about, you know, Dota kaise khelte hai, strategy kya hota
hai. I mean, what you want to be doing now is to try and punish the Spectre. But it is also a bit risky, right? You're seeing the Spectre all by itself. You don't see the rest of a team. You hope to punish the Spectre. VP though, you're chasing Acme. Want to give chase, both of them quick with their blink daggers, do end up retreating.
I mean, it's a trade-off between Shondi farming and the Spectre getting a Radiance. I think that's a trade that favors the Yakshas. That Radiance on the Spectre means that you're not going to have Acme blinking you with the Epicenter, you're not going to have Puck jumping in with the blink dagger. Rubik is just going to, I mean, he might as well just commit Atmahatya at this point to the Spectre plus his Haunt, because he's not going to survive when the Spectre comes at him.
I mean, there's a very ridiculous way to attempt to run away from a Haunt by a smoke. I mean, playing position 5, you learn things like this.
Radiant are buying scanning a smoke for enemies.
If Spectre is not keeping eyes as to where our Haunted illusions are going, you might just survive a Spectre if you buy a smoke. But that's very costly, and it's not worth like blowing smoke just to survive a Haunt. Instead, I'd like to see 11 buy Ethereal Blade. It could be a ghost set.
This is exactly what happened. They got a new item,
yeah,
the shiny BKB, pick up a smoke, and they run straight at them. What's the other side
the
doing?
Spyglass at hand.
Has Spectre got the Radiance? Yeah.
This could go horribly wrong for Yodhas if they're not prepared.
I mean, you're
fighting in an isolated area where the Chainfrost will rip you apart.
Oh, VP caught in the Stormhammer. Shondi did pop the God Strength. He still has the BKB. The Fisher's there. Backline Zaps has gone in. Coil under 3, Waning Rift as well. Acme being controlled by the Spectre Illusions 11, making a run for it as well. The Spectre starts to hurt, but look at that. Shondi doing his work. A quick remnant from Gondi ensures that he gets a double kill. One of them on the ledge. Stormhammer onto the Spectre. Do they have enough to bring it down? Acme shall be epicenter. He goes in with the Mono Strike. With the Whale, he'll get the kill. But the disruption. Durka gets another, always alone, giving chase. One melted onto Shondi. Ember providing control. Kalnayok with a disaster of an Echo Slap. But the Fisher is controlling Shondi. Shondi low on mana, low on HP, low on luck, running back to the shrine. But always alone will bring him down. It's a fight that favors the Yakshas. And Ember, he's still on a cliff. What have you done? He does have a remnant. He goes to the low ground. The Whale did track Kalnayok. But here's the TA coming back for sloppy seconds. Ember with the chains onto the TA, buying himself some time. Gondi doesn't have the blink dagger. Kalnayok goes in. Enchant told him a couple of hits on the Desolator. And Gondi will fall. Always alone, gets the kill. It's a team wipe going in favor of the Yakshas.
And it all started with Yodhas coming out and coming and fire. I don't even know what the hell the Ember was doing up on that cliff. I have no clue how he ended up there. He ran out of remnants. The only way you actually get up there is if you throw a remnant up there yourself and jump there. He jumped there without a TP score. That was absolutely clowny to watch. And now with an armor reduction lineup, what better objective is there to take after a team fight than Roshan himself? And Aegis will go into the pocket of all these alone. And while the Spectre may not have done much in the last fight, it was because Kalnayok was taken out of the equation early on and couldn't come in with the control and the stun that he brings to the table. They played well.
More than he managed to catch 11.
11 walking out there is him basically playing the Blue Ribbon Challenge. I don't know what the hell he was thinking. This is Garden Game.
Tower is under attack.
They have man advantage. Got the Desolator on the TA, they're gonna push the mid lane post the issue. How do the
Dire's middle tower is under pressure?
They're just gonna
Dire's
hold on to the
middle
high ground.
Tower just got knocked
right
down.
Okay, everyone's low on mana.
Still move on for the tier 1s and tier 2s.
Yeah, slow down, go back, regen up, and come into that next Aegis to fight. Maybe give the Spectre enough time to pick up the next item, which by the looks of it is going to be the Diffusal Blade. That Diffusal would have made all the difference in that last fight. There is no way for the Spectre to lock down on any of those targets, and even though she was trying to chase past just for a measly little Rubik, one stun, one Searing Chain, something along those lines is all it takes to stop her. The Diffusal would have allowed her to slow them down and bring them down before the stuns even came out in the first place.
The good news is 11 has a Ghost Scepter.
But the bad news is the Diffusion should be online by the time they find it.
It's a hard game to be a Rubik. I mean, 11, that Haunt is hurting him so much. Now the Spectre is going to have the Diffusion. what can you do? As a five position, you actually got to prioritize farm so that you get your gold scepter significantly before Spectre gets
under attack.
Gandhi, he was hoping he'd try and slow this thing down and farm on this.
Dire's bottom tower has fallen.
The moment he got there, he broke it and he just jumped back to the Kremlin.
But two towers in the tower won't last long.
Because of this, no one's going to come and defend when there's an Aegis on the FTA. He's also got a brand spanking new shiny BKB. Ready to be unveiled.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
No, they found Durka, or rather Durka, they bring it down. We actually missed it. But they commit everything and bring down the Spectre. The last time we saw a Spectre game, the mistake was to not go for the Spectre and isolate it on the side. Yodhas have learned. They've watched what their opponents are doing. They've come in and taken down the Spectre instead of going for the Spectre.
Dire are standing for enemies.
The good thing is that these Yodhas have these abilities. So pickoffs like this are not more possible for them. They did have that ward in the top lane where Durka was farming, and the information from that ward did allow them to go and kill the Spectre all by themselves. But look at this, the Yakshas are starting to group up and push top. I'd really like to see the Yodhas pick up fights. Spectre's not there. Shorty needs to be nearby. VP has gone in with the blink. 11 popped the gold center trying to stay alive. This is something but a melting of the Fisher. VP, he's low on HP. The TA pushes him back. He struggles a bit. But the Fisher's there. They've got Acme. They've bought down both supports on the side of the Yodhas. I said the Yodhas should be looking for a fight. Instead, it was the Yakshas who got the fight started. And with Sven and Ember nowhere in the vicinity, they end up winning a fight and taking a tier 1 tower.
I mean, Zubik died before he could pop the Ghost Scepter in that.
Yeah, I thought he popped the Ghost Scepter, but I was mistaken.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
He's alone, just manning up and taking that kill by himself there. I mean, he didn't get the crush support coming out from this Lara.
Dire's top tower is about to take the blood.
They were going into this 4v5, and now the Spectre is back online. And Abs has nowhere to go. What were you thinking, man? What were you thinking? I mean, during the Counter-Strike game, we saw Abs getting up and doing most of the sledging. Now he's getting it thrown right back at him. So even the pauses are going to come out to throw it in his face. This is why you don't sledge unless you're guaranteed victory.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm awestruck as well. You know, this brings back so many memories for me, so much nostalgia. Back in the days of Dota 1, both teams would get up, walk to each other and shout in their faces with the smell of bad breath and tea. But if we're back to that again, it's such a walk down memory lane to see Punk get riled up.
It may be a walk down memory lane for you because you're slightly better built than I am. For me, it's just triggering PTSD, man.
Good old days of Dota. And playing at a LAN. I mean, nowadays Dota is too surgical, too clean, no reach-outs anymore. The Counter-Strike players are a bit more expressive. By expressive, I mean like after they win every round, they'll say nice to each other.
But the Dota players are more about like hardcore, like handbook. That's what's been happening.
Those were the CS players, a magic break. I fail to understand that. But yeah, everybody's having fun. And this is esports at its finest. This is what it's about. Oh, top lane, TA though, she's not having too much fun. She needs to be careful. She's blown mana, so she's got the ability as well as the BKB. Gandhi, as well as 11, should ideally try and burn through that Aegis as soon as possible. But the Frost Armor is proving to be a little too much.
And also, no earns, no mechs. So you can't really get that TA back in fighting shape before going back up onto the high ground again. That's one of the issues with the lineup on side of Yakshas. Maybe. But Lich is just the sacrificial five.
Lich is this poor, man. But Punk has done his job.
He's done his job.
Yeah. Roshan has more net worth than Punk.
You've got to be the bigger man, and I don't mean physically, to play a role like the position five. You have to be able to say that, all right, I will not take the glory for this game. I'll die if I have to, as long as my teammates will win because I do that. And Punk is playing that role perfectly.
And honestly, it's not like he's been dying on hot.
Hold your thoughts, Conforme. You've got a fight taken out and found a Spectre. She has a play shield! Don't go into a Spectre with a play shield like that. She's done her job. She doesn't have the hot though, but the chase is on. Deep is the one getting hurt here. The fire set will come out, followed up by a blink of the enemy. The doom is there from the Puck. Puck will start to slow down as well. And it's the slow down that they're going to do it for.
But Arthur is alone, let's follow in his usage and bring it down. It's a Vector for a pop. And Shanti, if I'm not mistaken, whips up his box and can run away in that fight.
I think Yodhas are actually okay with that. You've got the Spectre, which is fine.
Yeah, but I mean, Spectre is going to respawn and just haunt back into your lane.
That's in 30 seconds, this fight will be a whole and different ball game.
Kalak still has the Echo Slam. Always Alone has the Butterfly. I'd really like to see a hood like you mentioned. Nobody has had the time or money to get one. But yeah, Always Alone, he keeps confident frontlining. They know that the community epicenter and almost everything on the Spectre. Spectre does have the on. The Yakshas realize that they could possibly try and force the issue a little bit and see Yodhas slip up.
They should. I don't see why the Yakshas are backing off right now, because you don't want to give this man enough time to the point where he gets that MKB and starts basically one-hitting everyone on the map.
Dire right now, you have the division
and the boss. Go in, all guns blazing.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
I'm not a fan of the Shadowmaker. I'd have liked to see him go for a BKB of his own, or even a 4-star.
Even a 4-star, or a hood.
I'll take
it. A hood on the loot shop. Either one of the sliding could help him see. That's what you want your 4-5 position supposed to do, right?
And look at this man. Because of the Shadow Maker, this might be really hard.
But where's the follow-up? VP should have waited. He did have time to calculate.
Oh, what are you doing, Acme?
The Bishop barely misses. And Acme barely gets home with that TP. He's got a hood, which is good news, actually.
Not really, man. I mean, talked about physical DPS on the side of the team. Why would he get a hood?
But for the Earthshaker and the Lich to some extent.
If you're planning to get hit by an Earthshaker and a Lich, I think you're doing it all wrong. Where's your Ghost Scepter? Where's your 4-star?
Maybe your 4-star for Ghost Scepter.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
You know, the age-old stick of
the Naya goes in charge of the Fisher, Echo Slam, everything thrown in on the maps.
Okay then.
I want to say the crowd goes wild, but here the players actually go wild.
That just happened. I mean, again, Absinthe is getting punished again and again. In an environment where your every mistake is being scrutinized by your entire opponent and you're being called out for it, and there's a lot of public pressure being put upon him, it could lead to him making a few more mistakes. But no Echo Slam for 80 seconds, I guess that's the big takeaway here for Yodhas, and the only thing they can really do is keep pushing out the waves so that they don't have to fight without actually losing, without actually getting any trades in exchange either. And we've talked about this before as well, right? When any Yodhas teams are in trouble, उनके दिमाग में एक ही स्ट्रेटजी आता है चलो स्प्लिट पुश करते हैं
दैट्स
व्हाट्स हैपनिंग और
आते जो इंडियन टीम्स है गंग से भी स्प्लिट पुश नहीं करते एनीवेज दे ग्रुप दैट नाउ दे पॉप द स्मोक दे वांट टू पिक अप इट सो दे कैन गो हाई ग्राउंड कैन एनीबॉडी ऑन द साइड ऑफ योर्स बी फाउंड आउट ऑफ पोजीशन हैक में फार्मिंग इज ओन जंगल ही थिंक्स इट्स सेफ वीपी डस हैव अ शैडो प्लेयर ही सीज़ द रन इज ऑन द फ्लोर ही गोस एंड ही गेट्स द क्रॉस द हॉर्न इज देयर एंड ऑलवेज अलोन एज वेल दे वांट टू डिफेंड शॉट यू शॉट ही बी विथड्रॉन शॉट ही डिड मैच टू पॉप अ बीकेबी टैग इज ट्राइड वांट टू रन बट डर्का इज हियर डर्का डिडंट मेक द डिफ्यूज प्ले देन नो योर कैच द टीम वाज कमिटेड टीम शॉट ओन हिम एज वेल दे वांट द स्वेन
They'll have it for sure. But that's not worth it, in my opinion.
Think of it. Home of the generation.
Chain Frost. The current origin of Ucypher seems to be on their last limbs as Durka and the Templar Assassin are stealing the show. Okay. He has the Echo Slam. The Haunt is back in 1 minute.
Is Roshan back up?
Not yet. Okay,
oh, now
there
you go.
And they know this. The Templar spotted this. 30 seconds without the Sven. Roshan, Aegis, Q is going over towards the Radiant.
Have a stand on the
lead. It's their game to lose.
Gaia have a scan. I'm curious to see if they do commit the scan when they see that everybody's missing off the map. They do, right?
Yeah. They got a low number.
I mean, then you'd want to contest. You just want to do things. Contest, Roshan, or hope you have a good high ground defense.
I think
you
should do
Roshan has fallen to the Radiant.
Top is pushed in, bottom is pushing out. And the only real lane that they can come marching down is mid. unless we lose the Spectre. Last time we lost, and then we go with 4 to the system. Templar's also got the money to pick up her deadlies if she wants to, but I'm in favor of a Bloodthorn instead.
I actually think so.
Oh yeah, a refusal may not be terrible either.
I mean, the Ghost Scepter's coming out, good versus Warcry, it takes away Flame Guard, so the Ember Spirit is not even protected by protected from magic damage from that Flame Guard.
Never mind, Deadliest it is.
Okay, it's harder.
I want to shock it.
The corrosive base could come in handy, especially when the Sven decides to mana versus that TA. And Shangi, I think this is a game where he skips the buyback and just buys out his NKD. We need to have that that true strike so that you can man fight versus the lone fight.
Yeah,
game. What's the game according to you?
To make all the really well. I mean, because the coming in from the Sand King and the Buck, if Shandi does have two strikes, he needs to bring down the TA. I like what Gandhi's done. Bought some time, but it's not enough. Also, in the mid lane, actually, Butter Strike onto the TA. He's scared as hell, but always alone. Showing a little bit of respect, just blinking backwards. The tier 3 tower, 400
there is
HP.
A fortification on the side of the Dire. They could pop
so
that fortification
to
now to defend the
Hive.
Yeah, it's a Dire. Just the extra vision in
Yeah, just the extra vision.
Okay. Raging Sentry is not a rage as well. So got more
vision
that
one.
Dire's middle tower has fallen. Dire's middle barracks have fallen.
Is this how Dire's middle barracks fall?
Double kill! Double kill!
Yes, that's how I give a dog on fighting it to God. 11, steal something, but it feels big in the way from the behind that. But then starting to come to a quick telekinesis, and a pause coming up from Slana.
Who then? Ugly business coming out from Yakshas, getting themselves that laner bag, essentially opening the game wide open in their favor.
Meanwhile, the main act goes in with the battle strike, they try to bring down the TA, he still has the agent. Dirk are running in, Dirk are low on mana, always alone, trying to bring down the TA on the end, the end is down his head. They've won on the end, they're focusing the second.
Dire's bottom tower is about to flounder.
And the Yodhas are on the back foot, always alone, not waiting with the triple kill. The Yakshas going away with two lanes of panic and the deciding point in today's game.
Dire's bottom barracks have fallen.
I don't know how they come back from this, but they're not that now yet. Yakshas may not have had the best run of time, but Yodhas is going to be their
choice. The coin is in the hand. Thank you, so I just pushed up back to the Yodhas.
The rest of Yodhas are crumbling as well. It's really boiling down to the fact that Yakshas secured the outdraft of Yodhas. Yodhas did try to make some early game momentum go in their favor, but the moment that team might have in favor of respective initiative team, they started to have all sorts of problems for Yodhas. Yakshas now sitting in a comfortable spot, pushing on the top lane, Haunt comes back online in 3 seconds, and you gotta remember, Always Alone is now coming in, buffed up with that full Deadliest that he picked up as well.
But they haven't got instant cheese, so if they do manage to hold on, it could be huge.
But
50 seconds without the Sven. And the Sven, like you mentioned, held on to buyback, didn't go for the NKB, and accomplished nothing with the buyback evil. I mean, if I'm not mistaken, when you buyback, the Godsend doesn't still linger on. And that makes a huge difference. Durka, he's taken the tier 3. Acme goes in with the butterfly, pops the touchdown, Puck coil onto 2. The VP Slaughter being controlled, but the Bannock's being taken down. And Always Alone, he wants to have a little bit of fun. He eliminates Gandhi. The crush is there from VP. The chain cross comes out from Punk. The Echo Slap, not used. The epicenter, little to no impact. The Yakshas have done it. The Yodhas have tapped out. A beautiful game coming up from Always Alone on the Templar Assassin. Look at that, the crowd goes Godcopper, Mulun, Hanto. The entire central line being chanted out here. What a day.
Congratulations to Yakshas for that win, an emphatic win that was necessary after they lost earlier in Counter-Strike.